Hi and welcome to session 29 of my SwiftUI for iOS 15 course. Today we're going to cover one of the most difficult techniques in iOS development and web development, and that is how to create a custom transition. The goal here is to have a seamless transition between one screen to another and animating the share elements between the two views. As a result, you create something that is immersive and really fun to use. So in order to achieve that, we're going to need to learn match geometry effect. Now there are many steps to the next videos, and I'm gonna try to teach step by step, but you can definitely expect a lot of interesting techniques along the way. Back to Xcode, let's create a new component. Since we're gonna have a lot of code and I don't wanna confuse you, sometimes it's best to start from scratch using a completely new view. So we're going to do that, and it's going to be temporary. Let's right click on views. We're going to create a new view, SwiftUI view, and we're going to name this one match view. Whenever you create a custom transition like this one, you want to plan things in the design file. So you have a beginning state and then the end state. And typically, you're going to have shared elements. So from this card to this full screen, you have the same titles, the same background, the same image. As a result, we're going to play with those same elements. In order to use match geometry effect, we're going to need a namespace, which is essentially the same as a state. It's a space where the animation is going to exist across multiple views or across the same view. So at namespace var namespace. Then we're going to need our animation state. So at state var show is equal to false by default. Once you have this resume, let's go to the text and we're going to change that to SwiftUI. This element here is going to be shared between the start and the end of the animation. So unlike a typical animation where you use the same element, we're going to duplicate this. But first, we need a parent container. So let's embed this inside a Z stack, and then we're going to copy this to get a second text. You don't see the change because one is on top of the other one. Next, for the animation, we're going to set a condition. So if show curly braces, then we're going to put the first text element, and else we're going to put the second text element. This is a matter of preference. I prefer to have the starting animation first. So I'm going to need to say if it's not showing yet, then show the first text, or else, which means when it's at the end of the animation, then show the second text. Next, we're going to need the event. For simplicity, we're going to tap on the whole Z stack, which is the full screen, and it's going to activate the animation back and forth. So we're going to set on tap gesture show.toggle. So far, this is a simple show and hide between two views. And if you tap play, you're going to see that it's not really doing anything. Now we can definitely try something like moving back and forth left and right. So we can use frame max width dot infinity. For the first one, we're going to set the alignment to leading, so the left, and we're going to copy this. For the second text, we're going to set to trailing. So again, I'm not using match geometry, and it's simply going to be instant. We're going to also set a transition using width animation, then put the toggle inside the curly braces. And now you can see that it's a simple fade in, fade out, because this is like a new view that goes on top of the first one and then hides back and forth. Now, where match geometry effect is going to be very different is that between these two views, it's going to transition perfectly. And in order to set up that, we're going to need to set dot match geometry effect, setting the ID as well as the namespace. The ID is just so that we can identify between the two shared elements across multiple views. So this is going to be the title, and the namespace is pretty much always the same. And then we're going to copy this on the second text. Now watch the magic. I'm going to tap on one, and it does a perfect transition, even though these are two completely different views. And that's what makes match geometry so interesting. But of course, this is just the start. Now, it is important to understand that when you're using match geometry, you have to keep the same integrity of the element before the modifier. And so, for example, if I want to set it to a font large title, and the second one does not have that, then you see that it's not animating perfectly. So in short, anything that is before match geometry effect should be the integrity of the element, such as the font size, the background color, etc. And ideally, you want to have almost exactly the same style between the two. So I'm going to set this to weight bold, and I'm going to copy this to the second text as well. And if I do that, then I have a perfect transition. Let's take it a step further. We want to have multiple elements, and we also want to have a container. So we're going to embed this inside a VStack, and then we're going to set a second text. So text this time is going to be 20 sections, 3 hours. We're going to set this to uppercase. Then the font is going to be footnote, weight, semi-bold. Again, the two views are going to be pretty similar, but this time I'm just going to copy and paste and replace the second view. And I'm going to move the first text to before the second text. And watch what happens. Again, you can see that the element that is using match geometry transitioned perfectly versus the element that is not is just using a fade-in, fade-out transition. So we're going to need to add match geometry for both. So match geometry, let's set the ID this time to subtitle. And again, using namespace, copy this for the second text. And now it transitions perfectly. As you can see, you can reorder the element and you can have a frame as long as it's not visual, meaning that it doesn't have some sort of a styling property, then your animation is going to be fine. Using padding, using spacing offset, it's going to work great. But what if you want to change the colors from one to the other? So for example, we can set foreground style, set it to white, and then copy that, set to black for the second. Right now, we can't really see it, so we can add a background to red first, and we're going to set a background to blue on the second one. Perfect. Now you can see that the text actually changes in color. It is important to note, though, that the transition is not going to work perfectly in the preview versus the simulator. And if you want to test that in the simulator, you're going to have to reference match view inside your app file. And we're going to build that. Then you can see that the transition works as intended in the simulator. Now back to match view. We're going to make each view more and more different as we go on. Let's start with having a spacer. This essentially means that it's going to take the full screen. Now notice that when I do this, the color itself is not transitioning properly. And that's because each element, including the background, should be using match geometry. So to fix that, we're going to replace .red by color.red, then .match geometry effect. The ID is going to be background, and using namespace again. So we're gonna copy the background and replace the blue. Instead of red, it's going to be a blue background. As a result, now it does the transition as intended. So there are a few rules that you need to understand here before we move further. And this is going to require practice. First, match symmetry effect should be used on individual elements, even including the color. Anything that is a styling should use that modifier. It's not really a good idea to use it on a V-stack or after a frame, especially when there's a position change or a size change, such as what we did for the font. Secondly, the individual elements should keep its integrity in terms of styling as long as it does not affect the size or the position. So the integrity should be done before the modifier, and the positioning should be done after. Next, when you reorder these elements, they're gonna work just fine. And finally, when you're not applying the match geometry effect, it's simply going to fall back to the default transition, which is going to be a fade in, fade out on the element. So for example, if it's a background color, then it simply show or hide the new view on top and then back and forth. So before we finish, we're going to make this layout a little bit more interesting. Let's set the alignment of the V-stack to leading, and I'm gonna set the spacing to 12. And let me apply the same every time that I make a change, and I want this to be exactly the same in the end view. I'm going to copy that. Then I wanna add some padding of 20. And this is for the inner part of the card. And for the outer part, I'm going to set it to 20 as well. Let me just copy that for the end view, but not for the outer parts. So you can see we have some padding at first, but at the end we don't have a padding, and this creates a better transition. Next, let's add a third text. So text, and I'm gonna use the design, copy from this text here, put that, set the font to footnote, and set the match geometry effect to text using the same namespace. So let me copy this element, and I'm going to put this before, and you can see that it does a transition, it reorders the element, and the background transitions properly. For the animation timing, you can of course customize by using, let's say, dot spring, and we can use a response of 0.6, damping 0.8. The blend duration, we don't need it. And if we build this, you can see that we have a nice bounce back. So I hope you learned quite a bit from this experience. And I think it's really important for you to experiment and try it hands-on. Otherwise, you don't understand what makes or breaks match geometry effect. But once you master this, you can create a really beautiful transition and have the ability to manage each view individually as you see fit. And that's what makes this technique so special. But of course, there's way more stuff to learn, and we're gonna cover how to have a fixed frame, how to have a masking, and how to have each view even more different from each other. So I'll see you in the next session.